Hello all, welcome to this course on computer organization. The topics we'll be dealing with today are IO system, accessing IO devices, modes of data transfer, programmed IO and interrupt driven IO. So let's begin. First topic is IO system. So IO system necessarily points to your input and output devices. So these are just pieces of hardware that are used to communicate with a computer. It can be either a keyboard that's used as an input device, or a printer that can be used as an output device, or devices that are both input and output, like your modem. Modem stands for modulator, demodulator. What it does is it sends digital data over a phone line. So you'll have two modems, one at the sending and another at the receiving side. The sending modem will modulate the signal to one that is compatible with your phone signal, and the receiving modem will demodulate it into digital data. Then you have a network card, a network interface card that is used to connect your computer to a computer network. So next, let's see how do we access these IO devices. So the simplest way of connecting IO devices to a computer is to use a single bus arrangement. Now, what is a bus? A bus is a shared communication system that transfers data between components inside a computer or between components that are external. That's why you have two kinds of buses, internal bus and external bus. Here you can see these golden lines. They are connecting all the components within your system, and external buses are used to connect external components. So this bus will necessarily include both the hardware components like the wires or optical fibers involved, and also the software that will be consisting of the communication protocols. Communication protocols are set of rules or message formats that need to be followed while you communicate through this bus. So this is the diagram of a single bus structure. Here you can see this bus enables all the IO devices connected to it to exchange information. Typically, your bus consists of three set of lines that are used to carry address, data, and control lines. And you will see in detail what these hardware components here stand for. You will see an address decoder here. So this address decoder is enabling the device to recognize its address when this address appears on the address lines. And you have a data register here. It holds the data being transferred from the processor. And the status register contains information relevant to the operation of your IO device. Both this data and status registers are connected to the data bus and are assigned unique addresses. The address decoder, the data and the status registers, and the control circuitry that are required to coordinate the IO transfers, they together form the IO interface for, in this case, an input device. Okay. And now let's see how does the transfer of data takes place between CPU and the devices connected. So the general order is like this. Each IO device will have a set of unique addresses. So when a processor will place a particular address on this address line, then the device will recognize that address. It will respond to the commands that are issued on the control lines. The processor might have asked for a read or a write operation, and the requested data will be transferred over the data lines through the data register. So this is the basic operation that takes place here. Now, we'll see the two ways in which an IO device is addressed by CPU. You saw that the address here, the CPU will place the address of the IO device with which it needs to communicate into this address line. So this address or that mode of addressing can be of two kinds. Can be either memory mapped IO or an IO mapped IO. Now let's see what is memory mapped IO. See, in this diagram you can see that you have an IO device here. Each IO device will have a control register, status register and IO buffer that is dedicated to it. Then you have an addressable region here, that is the set of addresses allotted to the IO device. Then you have the main memory and you have the processor. So you can see in the main memory that a particular area is shaded and marked as IO area, and that's mapped to a particular area in your IO device and called as addressable region. So what does this mean? This means that a part of the main memory address space is given for your IO device addressing also. So what is an address space? Address space is a range of valid addresses in the memory that are available. So that means a part of the main memory addresses is given for IO device also. That means here actually the IO device and the memory are sharing the address space. So this type of addressing is called memory mapped IO. That is, the IO device and memory, they share the same address space. And the biggest advantage here is it leads to a simpler software, because you are doing the addressing of IO device along with the main memory. You don't have a separate mechanism for that. So the software will be simpler. So now when we consider the case of IO mapped IO, there are certain processes that have special input and output instructions to perform IO transfer. That is in case where your IO address space is separate from your main memory address space. You can see here that you have a separate block, 64K memory, that is allocated for your IO addressing and 1 megabyte memory for your memory addressing. For example, when you take the processors in Intel family, they have special IO instructions and they will have a separate 16-bit address space for their IO devices. Okay. So when you're building a computer system with based on such processors, the designer can have the decision on whether to connect the IO devices to use these special IO address space, or just simply incorporating them as part of the memory address space. So the biggest advantage you see here is you can deal with lesser address lines. That's why you just allocated 64K. Also, you can see that we discussed that they have separate IO address space. So that doesn't mean that the IO address lines you saw here will be separate for both of them. Actually, they use a special signal on the bus that's passed through this line that indicates whether the requested read or write transfer is an IO operation. So when the signal is high, it means that the memory unit will ignore that requested transfer. And what happens is this IO device will examine the lower order bits of this address bus to see how it should respond. So that is all about IO mapped IO. Okay, so next let's see what are the different modes of data transfer. We are discussing two of them here, programmed IO and interrupt driven IO. So let's go on with programmed IO. So I'll be explaining it using an example of a keyboard and the status flag in it called SIN. SIN stands for status input. As you all know, the IO devices, they are operating at a speeds that are very different from that of your processor. So when a human is entering characters in a keyboard, the processor is capable of executing millions of instructions between these successive character entries. Any instruction that reads a character from the keyboard should be executed only when a character is available in the input buffer of the keyboard. Earlier we saw that in this example, each IO device has an IO buffer that is associated with it. So the keyboard character, if there is an input, needs to be read only if it is available in the input buffer. Also, we must make sure that the input character is read only once. Okay, so that there shouldn't be an error. So when you take the case of keyboard, you have a status flag called SIN that is included in the interface circuit as part of the status register here. So this flag is set to 1 when the character is entered in the keyboard, and it's cleared to 0 when this character is read from the keyboard by the processor. Hence, by checking the SIN flag, the system can ensure that it is always reading a valid data. So how this is accomplished? So the same thing is shown in the form of a flow chart here. I'll explain it after this. So how do they accomplish this checking? They use a programming loop that repeatedly reads the status register and checks the status of SIN. So when this SIN becomes 1, then the program reads the input data register. A similar procedure can also be used to control your output operations using you have a similar output status flag called SOUT, S-O-U-T. So based on the example I said, you can verify this flowchart. So here we are showing the flowchart of how a read command is given to an IO device by the CPU to read a word and write it into memory. So first you issue the read command that is given by the CPU to the IO device, and next the IO will give its status to the CPU, and the CPU checks the status whether it's ready or not. If it's not ready, it will keep on reading the status until the IO device is ready, and if it's ready, it will read the word from the IO module and give it to the CPU. The CPU will write that word into memory. You'll check whether this instruction has been completed. If it's yes, it goes to the next instruction. And if it's a no, it goes to the issue read command module again, repeating this until this gets over. And if there is a state between ready and not ready, then it's called an error condition. So, as a summary, what happens in programmed IO is the processor repeatedly checks a status flag to achieve the required synchronization between the processor and the input-output device. That's what you saw here. So that is programmed IO. So this process can also be called as the processor polling the device. So polling means you are actively sampling, like in this step, you're actively sampling the status of this flag register here, or it can be of any device, that is the status register of this IO device. It's done by a client program. That is, here you are using a loop as a synchronized activity. Yes, you continue it until you get a positive value, 1. That is, the status is ready. Till then, it continues this loop. Next, we'll see what an interrupt-driven IO is. It's also explained with a similar flowchart. Now, let's see what is the difference here. See, it's issuing the read command to the IO module, that CPU is giving the read command to the IO device. And you see here that it's given as do something else. So interrupt-driven IO, what happens is, as we have discussed earlier, CPU can do millions of instructions by the time you enter something or by the time you issue a read command. So instead of making the CPU wait unnecessarily here, see, sometimes this loop can go on forever. So the CPU is waiting for a status from your IO. You can avoid it here by making the CPU free after it issues a read command. And then what it does is, it asks an interrupt to read the status of IO module and report it to the CPU, so that the CPU can come back once the status is read. Till then, it can be involved in some other activity. So when the interrupt comes, that is after the IO will send its status to the CPU, an interrupt will be generated, an interrupt request telling that the IO device has shared its status. Then you check the status. If it's ready, you will read the word from IO and write the word to the memory as usual. And if it's done, you go to the next instruction. And if it's not done, you will repeat the issuing of read command. If it's not ready, it will go to an error condition. So what is the difference here? You had extra loops here, right? Not ready. We eliminated it. How? An interrupt is generated only when it's ready with the status. So that is what is given here. Interrupt facility and special commands are there to tell the interface to issues an interrupt request signal when the data is available. Meanwhile, this interrupt will keep on monitoring the device. So when the interrupt determines that the device is ready for a data transfer, it generates an interrupt request to the system. That is how an interrupt driven mechanism works. So those are the two modes of data transfer: programmed IO and interrupt driven IO. So that's all. Thank you for listening.